Hello everybody. I, Mrs. Aradhana Ambre, welcome you all on the last session of 5th Bharatiya Vigyan Sammelan in Vishwakarma Hall, and today's theme is astronomy. I wholeheartedly welcome today's session chairperson, Dr. Somak Raychaudhury, director of IUCAA. I request Shweta Laddha to welcome him and felicitate him. And after that, I would request Somak Chaudhary sir to take over the session. Thank you, Shweta. I request Chaudhary sir to take over this.
Okay, so please come in quick. In this parallel session, I mean, the parallel sessions are being done in very different ways. In this one, what we have is that we have three talks of duration 25 minutes each, and we will have 5 minutes of discussion after the talks. For each speaker, I will give you an indication that you have 5 minutes left, okay? My name is Somak Raychaudhury. I'm the director of IUCAA. And as you know, in IUCAA, in Pune for the last 30 years, we have done all kinds of astronomical research. And many of it, I mean, in this theme that is there in the PBS this year, connecting the traditional to the modern astronomy, there has been quite a lot of work done. By my colleagues, starting from Professor Narlikar, as you know, who set up IUCAA, and which continues to do that. In looking at this connection, we heard a fantastic presentation by Professor Maimbaya in the plenary talk of how our tradition continues to this day. And so we have, based on that theme, we have now chosen three topics where we look in depth at some aspects of just this connection, right? So the first speaker I'm very happy to introduce to you, Professor Dr. Rathnasree, who started off his life as a practicing radio astronomer. She did her PhD at the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research and worked quite a lot on radio pulsars. She also did quite a lot of research abroad in the US at the University of Vermont, and then came back to India and is now one of the leading educators of astronomy in the country. She is the director of the Nehru Planetarium and Science Center in Delhi. And she will talk about the importance of the Jantar Mantars and what they represent in Indian astronomy.
Thank you, Professor Somak Raychaudhury, for the very nice welcome. Is it okay? My mic is all right? Mic is all right? No. Or maybe I don't need the mic for this small room. Is it okay if I don't use the mic then? So thank you, Professor Somak Raychaudhury, for those very kind words. And also to BVS for giving me this opportunity of meeting all of you here and sharing some aspects of certain structures, technological structures which have been built around in our country, with which I have been working for several years, and which to me any structure which is built in this spirit has become like, I mean, something which I really love very much, and I kind of find that, okay, I've reached home. If I find a structure like this, I feel I've reached home. And I would just like to spend as much time as possible studying structures of the sky. Now, these observatories, the Jantar Mantar observatories, we have four of them extant in the country, and one more which was built, which is no longer extant, in Mathura. So there we have the one in Delhi, the largest observatory, the Jaipur one, and small observatories in Ujjain and Varanasi. And to some extent, I was just thinking that we have started from relatively more modern times. We are going to go back and forth to much earlier times. So here we have constructions which were done in relatively modern times. In fact, 100 years after telescope was brought into use to study the skies, and it opened up so many newer views of the skies. And so to some extent, there has been critical thinking about these observatories, though I do feel somewhat they have been a little bit maligned also in these critical thinking, in terms of asking the question, why did more medieval methods were used when compared to relatively more emergence of modern technologies for observing what was there in the sky. Now, these were built by Savai Jai Singh, a king who had an intense interest in astronomy, and who studied various schools of this which he had access, and he also sent out groups of team from his side to study in Europe, which went to Spain, Portugal, these regions. And he did, this was considerably after he actually constructed these observatories. And in fact, a telescope was also bought to him from this. This is actually, this was earlier in a room inside the the Jaipur Jantar Mantar Observatory. The telescope, this is actually the celestial globe, which was bought to him. Now, his interest had been that he wanted to have accurate So, his interest in constructing these gigantic, very beautiful, very aesthetic, very intriguing constructions came about from the fact that he wanted accurate ephemeris content, just tables of positions of objects in the sky on his, contemporary times for him. And using those, he wanted to be able to then calculate the upcoming positions of sun, moon, planets, etc., and thereby have an accurate calendar. That was his intention. And when he tried to use traditional methods to make these calculations, he found certain differences, and his idea had been that now I will take these tabulated values to date and then be able to do my positional astronomy ahead. And that was his intention. And when the telescope was bought to him, this in fact looks like the telescope did not have the kind of instrumentation. Telescope opened up new views of the sky, but initially, to begin with, it did not give that ability to measure accurately angles in the sky until later instrumentation came into it. That came maybe a few decades later, and its spread was not as wide. It was not as widespread as the telescope itself was, and he found it wasn't answering his purpose. And then the spirit in all of this was to try and construct stable structures on the ground, gigantic in size whenever possible, so to have better and better least count and make measurements of time and positions of objects in the sky. So that was. Now, these observatories have also been called poignantly anachronistic, that is one term which has come to it, arising from the fact that they did not use telescope also as part of the observatory. Now, if we see anywhere in the world, in Europe, for instance, Paris Observatory in those times did also have instruments in this spirit, like sextants and quadrants, etc. However, they adapted use of those for position measurements by adding telescopic sights to them. So that was one thing. Telescopic sights, if they had been added to these instruments, they would have had substantially enhanced that usage. So that is one of the reasons why it has been called that. However, there is also one other aspect of these observatories which hasn't been appreciated. And Jai Singh set out to build these observatories with two purposes in mind, and he has stated this explicitly, at least the second purpose, definitely. The first was he wanted for his own use for calendar creation and so on. The second, which he has stated explicitly in the, essentially the work done, all his endeavors summarized in Zij-e Muhammad Shahi, he has stated that, I want that the common citizen should be able to come into these observatories and be able to take their own measurements and appreciate what is it that astronomers do and feel satisfied. So that part of what he say, I mean, what was his intention, somehow did not really bear fruit over the coming few hundred years. On the one hand, the constructions which were built, they were all built with rubble masonry structures, the very many intriguing structures that we saw in the first slide, and I'll show a few more detailed slides later. I don't know how visible these small images are, but in some time we are going to go and see all the detailed images. But all of them have this one large triangular wall and associated structure, and the Delhi and Jaipur observatories have the largest of these, the Samrat Yantra for time measurement, and with a least count of 2 seconds in this. So which, for anybody who is kind of looking at sundials out of just curiosity, like garden sundials which are there in several places in Europe, one doesn't think of 2 seconds of time as something which one associates with a sundial. Hilaire Belloc has said that I am a sundial, I make a watch of what is done far better by a watch, something of that kind. So, but these have been built with 2 seconds of accuracy, and then I'll talk a little bit about practically when we do, what is it that we face with it, and do we get those 2 seconds? We do. I'll say conditional, yes, we do, and then there are some aspects in this. So that's those are the main, every one of these observatories. This is a very interesting one, small, on the terrace of kind of a palace, small, built in Varanasi on the ghats of Ganga. This is called the Manmahal, Man Mandir, and this was built by an ancestor of Jai Singh, actually. It's much older monument, and there was a visitor, Robert Barker, who came just a few decades after Jai Singh's death, and then he had a local information that there's a very old observatory, and he has written actually that this is Akbar's time's observatory and so on. And then of course later it was corrected. So in any way, that is now called the Man Mandir Observatory, and it's a small one. It looks like more or less he used it for, this was more or less for his personal purpose, because all these places, they were built these palaces, and upstairs the people who built it would live. Downstairs would be a huge room which will facilitate people from their region to come, who have come to visit Kashi. So they would be staying there. So this was the one which was more personal, and everything else was in public space. And then, so he intended that he did succeed in this one specific endeavor of his, that he wanted accurate calendar purpose. And in fact, I think Rajasthan Panchang continues to use these content. On the other hand, these instruments which have survived these 300 years, they have been various kinds of ravages, and time to time there have been some building back of these instruments. But if we look at what, before I come to after Jai Singh what happened, this is just a speculation on my part, but here is a copy of a painting from Bundi around mid 18th century. And I really am not at all in this field, I should not be saying anything, but still looking at this very beautiful thing, the fact that there seems to be a bit of astronomy in this, which not too, like these are the Ragamala series of paintings, and we don't see in this description of sky typically, and looks like a total solar eclipse depicted the stars and the birds which are, so could be, I mean, his influence. He did have role to play in Bundi region, but then after his death, Tiefenthaler, he visited India, and then he visited Delhi, I think just few years after Jai Singh's death, Delhi as well as Jaipur, and he writes about how all the instrument surfaces have been slicked up with lime, and that they are not in a usable condition. So just a few years after that. And I was just going to apologize to those of you who have heard me talk about the Jantar Mantar Observatory many times, but saying that I do have a few more points I wanted to discuss, which I have not mentioned earlier. And so one of them is, if you look at times after Jai Singh, how it has been, what has been the condition of the observatory. One reference I found very recently, it was very thrilling to find, it's generally believed that once he died, his astronomical efforts perished at that time, and they were no longer looked at as something useful to do from science point of view. And there is even one comment about how one of his descendants used the gigantic astrolabe he built in Jaipur for gun practice and so on, and that everything went down with that. But one reference I found very recently was a little later, early in 19th century, one of the court astrologers of in Muhammad Shah's times, I mean, or whatever, later Mughal times after that, Mubashir Khan, and his daughter, who was later known as Badshah Begum, and she was wife of Nasiruddin Haider, who was one of the second Nawabs of Lucknow, who kind of decoupled from the Mughal and became an independent king of Awadh. And she is supposed to have had been taught the entire usage of the Jantar Mantar Observatory. This is what is written by a contemporary chronicler, in fact, who is somewhat critical of her, but he talks about how she was very adept in doing this kind of science. So there was some usage following that, definitely for actual taking of observations. So that was nice to know. However, if you look at any writings of people who have passed through and they just looked at these interesting structures and wanted to know what they are, or people who have actually depicted them for us. So there are these etchings by Daniel Brothers, who actually just maybe a couple of decades after Jai Singh's death. But strangely, we find that the Samrat Intra, this construction basically is for time measurement, and we'll see this gigantic triangle, the angle in this should become equal to the latitude of that location, and then this becomes parallel to the axis of rotation of Earth, and this is then perpendicular to that, parallel to the equator. And the reason why all these kind of constructions are done, as opposed to, let's say, using the straight pole, which itself is also very powerful, we saw in the plenary talk how powerful a simple shenku is. However, this will make our calibration of time very easy, because shadow moves in equal intervals of time, it moves equal distance. So that's right. Now, Tiefenthaler has said everything was lit up with lime. However, here in Daniel's depiction, this seems very nicely done. And even Hunter, who came little after, has written how this is all surface with marble. So perhaps Savai Jai Singh's son, Madho Singh, who presumably built the Mishra Yantra in Delhi, because there is no mention of that by Tiefenthaler, may have resurfaced these with marble. I am just emphasizing this point a little, because there is currently a bit of an ongoing controversy for renovation. There is a school which says we should resurface everything with marble, and there is another school in which I am a very intensely interested member, which says no, please no marble. No marble on the surfaces of any measuring instrument, because marble translucency is very bad for shadows. And when I talk about some of the readings we have done with these gigantic instruments, I'll again try to emphasize that point. So, but that's a little bit of history immediately after Jai Singh's death, and things seem to be reasonably, of course, in these etchings and all, they may have had been artist license. Now, this is Metcalf. So, this is sometime before 1857. And this description, of course, depiction is a little, lot of license, lot of artistic license in this, because this cylindrical structure, this is called Ram Yantra, and it's actually beautifully aesthetic instrument. It doesn't look for its original beauty. And this cylindrical instrument, you have a kind of an open roof cylinder construction, and in this cylinder construction, the sky above our head is reflected in the cylinder, inner surface of the cylinder. Every point in the sky is a point inside the cylinder, and there is a gnomon in the center. The height of that should be equal to the floor length, and therefore if the sun is at a 45 degree height, the shadow will be at the junction between the wall and the floor. And so the angular height of the sun can be measured very nicely in this. And if you use a simple Shenku for measuring height, we have those two infinities. The 90 infinity tangents come in measuring the altitude here, and also for tan 0 we need, you know, it goes to infinite length by just halfway through making it perpendicular is very neatly handled in measuring altitude. So that's this depiction was by William Simpson's, and this was immediately after 1857. Two people came to document various places in India. And he's not so well known. Felice Bito is much better known. And there's a little later and photographic. This sort of looks at, this is a Samrat Yantra, everything desolate, everything broken, and there's even some air driven skeleton and so on. So of course, the artist's intention of depicting post 1857 India is also inherent in this. However, it's clear that the instrument has had several breakdowns here and there. Though in all of this, the basic structure is intact. The marking, where the markings are, etc., and some of the surroundings, they're all broken. But the basis, this is Lala Deen Dayal, 1880s. And so again, there is a lot of broken structure, but the basic part with which you can take observation still to some extent intact. Here the quadrants also seem to be substantially damaged. And in 1905, in the coronation, they seem to have had in a complete restoration of the Delhi Observatory. But once again in 1918, when Kaye was actually looking at this observatory as a whole, all the observatories, he again talks of how everything is washed out. I mean, there are no markings left. And that seems to be because the markings originally, presumably, were done in lime plaster surfacing. And that is actually the closest we get to like a clean white page. And that is good for observations. But however, it's not stable. So it seems like within 10-15 years it has been washed out. So one plea from those of us who have been doing law observations with this to the authorities renovating this was, keep this in mind that it is going to go away in 10 years or so. However, still do it in lime plaster, but keep templates in place so that every 10 years the last 3 mm surface is redone again and again. Once the template is in place, it could be done. The reason it hasn't been done all this time is in between there was nobody to take interest, or suddenly somebody takes interest, and like that. That is what has been happening for these 300 years. And this is also probably Lala Deen Dayal. This is the Delhi Observatory, the Ram Yantra, Samrat, and all of these somehow there is another hemispherical bowl instrument, which is, this is Noguchi from Japan, 1949 view. One thing here is that we see that this is the Samrat Yantra and this is the arc, and you see that about a half of the arc, other part, is submerged in water. It's not very clear in this, but if you actually see the image, it's submerged in water. So that was 1949, and in 1990s, V.N. Sharma, who has written the definitive book on this, Savai Jaising in his Astronomy, also talks of this being flooded with water. Sometime, maybe from an earlier visit of his, but at some time, not 1990s, but could have been sometime in 80s visit. So at some time, this part which is submerged in water, half of it was covered up by concrete, by the Archaeological Survey of India. Perhaps they feared the water seepage to damage the whole instrument, but however, half of the instrument was covered up. So in 1990s, when the Astronomical Society of India members had there's a paper program for restoration of the Jantar Mantar Observatory. They also looked at it and saw that half of it is removed and no markings, etc., etc. So all of these looks at the observatory have generally been emphasizing the fact that there are no markings, it's in such a damaged condition, and therefore it is not usable. That has been the thing which has emerged from everything which was, whatever look was given to the observatory earlier. And then the thing is that these observatories, although they look like very strange kind of constructions, but with just a little bit of help, with a little bit of help from friends and astronomers, they are actually very user-friendly spaces. We have done many